Welcome, everyone. It's a Memorial Day holiday weekend, and in the words of Monty Python, and now for something completely different.
Welcome back to the zoo. We're so happy to see you again.
We're pushing aside our regular reporter roundtable to bring you the leaders of some of our biggest attractions, from the head of the just reopened Kansas City Zoo to the head honchos at the still very much closed Sprint Center, Starlight Theater, and the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. They were among the first to close. Will they be the last to reopen?
Starlight stands to lose over $3.5 million this year.
We pull back the curtain next on Week in Review.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gourley, Smithfield Foods, Haas and Wilkerson Insurance, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Nick Haynes, and thank you for celebrating part of your holiday weekend with us. Checking in with us on our magical digital Zoom board is Randy Wistoff, the head of the Kansas City Zoo, Brenda Tinnen, who runs Sprint Center, Bob Kendrick, who leads the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, and Richard Baker, the man in charge at Starlight Theater, who, by the way, is our very first guest to have contracted coronavirus. Really? Well, we'll get into that shortly. But Randy Wistoff, I want to start with you because you are one of the very few attractions in our entire metropolitan area that's open to visitors. You're just wrapping up your first full week. Did you get more people coming in than you expected or fewer?
A little fewer than what we had anticipated. We had a cap on attendance at 4,000 for each day. We've been hitting about 2,600.
Now, if I came to the zoo last year and then I came now, what would be the big differences?
Well, first of all, the crowd size. Normally this time of year, we'll have 10, 12, 15,000 people a day. So, but the time ticketing, all the queuing, the restrictions on where people can go, one-way pathways. We've cut all of our rides. We're just down to our tram right now. Stopped all of our shows and chats. We're doing that with QR codes. Numerous changes throughout the zoo.
Bob Kendrick, the mayor, says museums are permitted to reopen as of May 15th under the Kansas City 10-10-10 plan, as they like to call it. The World War I Museum just announced they're going to be reopening the first day in June. No announcement yet, though, from the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. Why?
Realistically, we're looking at bringing our team back into the office the first week in June, and then the following week opening the museum, so hopefully in time for Father's Day. And so right now, that's the game plan. It is fluid, and it's kind of interesting for us because we are actually in a city building. And so there are various sets of protocols that we have to try to adhere to.
Now, Brenda Tinnen, I was just on your website at Sprint Center, and it's a laundry list of shows, postponed, 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 canceled. Are you blocked from reopening by government order, or is it that you were trying to find a better way of reopening in a safe fashion?
Well, both of those, Nick. Right now, under phase two of the city's reopening, Sprint Center, or is it considered a non-essential facility, is where we fall in. On the other side of that, we are working diligently to put together some types of protocol once we do have a show that confirms and we are able to move forward and get back to live music and sports and entertainment.
What about the performers that who would be coming to Sprint Center? I noticed you got Elton John this year, Cher, for instance. Are they saying to you, hey, we'd love to come, you just give us the word, or are they nervous too?
As you know, Elton and Cher do 40, 60, 80. Elton now is up to 300 some shows that need to be routed. And it's like a patchwork quilt of different coming back across America. So what might be allowed in Kansas City across the state in St. Louis may be something different. So I believe that the folks that are routing those tours are trying to stitch together something consistent across the U.S. as they tour.
Well, Richard, over at Starlight Theater, you are different because you're outside. Does that mean it's easier for you to reopen? And do you have plans to reopen imminently?
Well, not imminently, but we do have plans to reopen. I think the fact that we're outside does help. For example, our seats would self-sanitize every day under the sunlight, which in an indoor facility you'd have to worry about. But just like Brenda, the problem that we're running into is putting the tours together. Because if you would have asked me a week and a half ago, we still had a couple Broadway tours that swore they were coming, so don't worry about it. And then all that changed. And for all practical purposes, the Broadway tours have canceled for the entire summer. We're still planning on doing our own self-produced program, assuming we can come up with a plan that the mayor approves. But I'm a little hopeful that for that, because I was on a phone call with him with a bunch of arts leaders about 3 weeks ago, and he even used us as an example that Starlight might be able to reopen earlier because they're outdoors.
But what about the performers themselves? We always concentrate on the health and safety of the audience. But when you look at Starlight Theatre, you have big productions. I think you have Godspell coming up, and you were going to do My Fair Lady too. These are big productions. People are singing at the top of their lungs. Things do come out of your mouth. Are they going to be performing in face masks?
Well, quite frankly, that's one of the reasons we chose Godspell. It's a small cast. There's only 10 people, so we can space them out on stage. We're using all local actors and a local director because we want to give back to the community. But interestingly enough, as you asked, the director's already talked about the fact that he could put the performers in masks. For example, Jesus might be in a Superman mask and, Judas in a skull and crossbones or something. So we're going to have to be creative. But yes, we're concerned about both the safety of the patrons and the actors.
Is that the concern over at Sprint Center too, Brenda?
Yes, it is a concern that I have heard from some of the artists as they talk about moving forward, is how can they be safe as a group on stage? The shows that we had booked and that are postponing don't have as big a cast on stage as they do at Starlight or with Broadway. But yes, that is a concern of everyone, and especially the crews that are touring, that are in the production trucks and the buses and all of the backstage crew.
Randy Wistoff, let's go back to the zoo for a moment, because we saw all of those national headlines, in fact, global headlines about the Bronx Zoo, for instance. Multiple animals, tigers and lions, contracting COVID-19. Have you had any animals at the zoo with the virus?
No, we haven't. That really did take the zoo world a bit by surprise. They have assumed that came from an employee that was asymptomatic, that a keeper that passed that on to the tigers, and somehow that spread to some of the other cats. We have not, that's a different test that those animals take also. Our animals have not exhibited any signs. That was what happened in the Bronx. The tigers started doing a lot of coughing and wheezing, so there were symptoms. Our animals have not exhibited anything. We haven't tested any, but we did go into a different keeper protocol, and we are keeping our guests back a little further from all of our cats.
You know, you were closed for about 2 months. What was the impact on the animals there? Did they notice that, hey, whatever happened to everybody?
They did. They are wild animals, but they get accustomed to having people around, and they love it. We actually got into a routine. We have some of our ambassador animals that we use in our animal shows. We actually took them around the zoo to visit other animals to kind of stimulate and encourage. We've actually got a Polish chicken that likes to ride on a perch in a wagon. So our staff took the Polish chicken out around the zoo, took the chicken down to the orang exhibit, see the gorillas. It's quite comical. We were real serious about doing it for enrichment for our animals, but it was quite comical. But everybody, all the animals loved it.
Bob Kendrick, you've been closed since March 14th, and this is a huge year for you. This is the centennial of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. It started off amazingly well. You had Major League Baseball and the Players Association giving you $1 million. Fabulous. And then you've been shut down since then. You tell Newsday, it feels like we've been in a long horror movie and it just won't end. Do you still feel that way?
Yeah, you know, when you have your nightmares and you fall down, and no matter how hard you're trying to get up, and the monster is gaining on you, and you just can't get up, that's kind of how you feel. And so, yeah, your spirits are a little bit down. But as I've shared on a number of occasions, if you're going to be a steward of this story, there is no way you can wallow in self-pity. These athletes never cried about the social injustice that they had to endure. They went out and did something about it. And so hopefully we'll use the spirit of the Negro Leagues to try and again figure out a way to salvage the centennial celebration.
Brenda Tinnen, you don't know when you're going to reopen at Sprint Center, but you are working on plans. What might it look like when your customers come back into Sprint Center? Are we talking about every other row that there will be people? What would it actually look like?
Well, Nick, a lot of that will depend on what the artist wants to see, and of course, what the city and state and county codes are at that point in time. We have looked at several scenarios of selling seats in clusters. For instance, if the ticket limit for a particular artist is four, you would sell four together, and then there probably would not be anyone directly next to you, in front of you, or behind you. I call it the checkerboard pattern. I would imagine we can space out the seats on the floor accordingly. But I do believe the artists will have some say in how they would like their seats to be sold.
We had a lot of questions from our viewers for all of you. And I want to start, this is from KCPT viewer Sarah in Westwood. And I'm going to ask you this question, Richard. She says, some are suggesting concert lengths could be reduced so acts can perform multiple times in a day to try and make up for the lost revenue. Then they can have smaller audiences. Is that something you're looking at?
Good luck convincing an artist to do that.
Okay, all right.
In the old days, they used to. I mean, when I was at the Fox Theater in St. Louis, the country acts would do two shows in a day. It's very, very hard to get them to do anything like that anymore. Just like Brenda, we're looking at kind of the checkerboard pattern, but at some point, you have to have at least a certain capacity or it doesn't make sense. You can't cover the cost of the show, and then it doesn't make any sense to do it.
KCPT viewer Neil in Kansas City wanted to weigh in. He writes, just my two cents here. How about forgoing audiences altogether and introducing some sort of video on demand streaming service of the performance paid for by an electronic ticket you can get with a code via email, Brenda? How does that sound?
Well, you know, he's very forward thinking. I have heard of some some technology that is out there that some artists were experimenting with before everything shut down. And while I do think that that could be a viable option, I do believe that live music, live entertainment loses something when you lose the whole mass of people that are there to experience a particular artist. I think it's fine. You could get the streaming in your home, which is great. And I've been doing a lot of that lately. But there's just something magic about being in the artist, in the arena, or at Starlight Theater with everyone else who you know loves that particular artist.
KCPT viewer Robert in Mission asks, if there are fewer people coming through your doors, does that mean ticket prices will go up, Richard?
Well, no, we wouldn't plan to increase ticket prices. But the question is, at the current ticket prices, can we put enough people in the seats to make it make sense? But no, we wouldn't take it out on the consumer.
But, you know, Randy, over at the zoo, I mean, it does require a certain number of people coming through your turnstiles every day to make it worthwhile you having as many staff as you do. So there has to be a certain threshold to make a profit, right?
Well, there does. Right now, we're in a reassignment mode. We've taken our entire staff, those that are education, we're not doing tours and camps and those sorts of things right now. So we've reallocated staff in to help in any place possible. Moving forward, I think we have to see how many people do show up, what the per caps are, if they buy food here, if they use the gift shop, then plot out. We're feverishly working on what the end of the year looks like, and trying to work a worst case scenario and work backwards from there. But as my compatriots here on this phone call or this interview, it's all about the number of visitors and per caps. That's how we make a living.
And how does that work out for you, Bob Kendrick? Yes, you got the $1 million from Major League Baseball as we started the year, but that's not going to last forever.
No. But right now, you're just in survival mode to try and make sure that you can get through these next, however, 10, 12 months, you know, with less pain as possible.
But I've seen surveys, Bob. I've seen surveys of your national associations talking about how many museums are simply not going to reopen as a result after this pandemic. Does that keep you up at night?
It doesn't keep me up at night, but it gives you something to think about, because the museum business is a challenging business to begin with. And you're always out there vying to try and get new museum goers and try to find ways to get repeat visitors. You throw in a pandemic and you can see why everybody's nervous. We've come up with a program that we call Pitch In. And it's had really some success, Nick, where we've gotten people to kind of offset some of the admission that we would have missed. You know, you make a donation of $10 or more, we're going to pay it forward by inviting students to come to the museum free of charge. So that helped us generate some revenue to at least offset some of the admission that we were missing.
You're all trying to be relevant and keep yourselves relevant to your own audiences. You got lots of national news, Randy Wistoff, this past week for bringing your penguins to waddle around the art-filled halls of the still-shuttered Nelson Gallery.
We are so happy to today welcome our colleagues from the zoo, and they brought special friends, and actually we're seeing how they're reacting to art.
Was that your idea, Randy Wistoff, or did Julian over at the Nelson beg you to bring the penguins over there?
It was a great idea. I'd love to say it was mine. I got a crazy call from a crazy art museum director with a crazy idea, and I jumped in with both feet. I think we're all looking for chances to cooperate, do some cooperative things. And Julian suggested it, we did it, and it did got global reach. So we're happy we did it.
It certainly did. I was just wondering, though, when the cameras were turned off, did the penguins leave any evidence of their appearances there on the shiny floors of the gallery?
That was the first thing I said to Julian. You know what penguins do. Yeah, your collection doesn't do what my collection does. So we were well-armed to take care of that. They did that leave some...
Now, could they also go to the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum? Would you want penguins over there, Bob? Or are you more of like a Tiger King?
No. The penguins are always welcome here. Yeah, absolutely. We'll figure out a way to put them in a monarch cap while they're going through the place.
See, we're giving you ideas. And Brenda, if you were willing to share some of your animatronic dinosaurs and perhaps some of the big trucks or even the WWE wrestlers that come through Sprint Center and they go over to the zoo, they may be able to bring some of the animals over to you too.
I would love to see some elephants come through the elephant door at Sprint Center.
Well, if I came to Sprint Center today, what would I actually see? Is it just the lights are totally off? Are you actually doing anything?
Actually, we have started bringing some of our staff back to work. We have not shut down completely. We have had 24-hour security. Skinnied it down for now.
When I started this program, in our tease for this program, Richard, I mentioned you were the first guest we've ever had on this program, or at least we know of, that had the coronavirus. And not just that. You survived. That was while on a brief visit to Spain. You came out of that. You recovered. Do you still feel any of the lingering effects today?
No, but honestly, I was one of the lucky ones. I had very minor symptoms to begin with. I had a slight fever for a couple evenings and a little bit of a cough. I will say when I first got back from Spain, there was a little bit of fatigue that I didn't expect. But I got over that pretty quickly, and now I'm really at 100%.
How has this changed in any way your thinking about how our local and state governments have been responding to this pandemic?
Well, it's interesting because it was slightly different than the way Spain approached it. So far, we haven't been in any danger of overrunning our medical professionals, which is really the huge concern, is if it got out of hand and the hospitals couldn't handle it. Virtually all of the people that get this do recover. Some have various kinds of symptoms and severity of symptoms, but only about 2% or less of the people actually is it a fatal thing for. So I think overall we're doing a pretty good job.
By the way, just like we mentioned with Randy and they did their zoo video, you also are doing your best to connect to your audiences. I just saw this really well done video from your Young Performers program, taking us from Hamilton to Dear Evan Hansen.
Until we're able to meet under the stars again, we hope you'll enjoy this song. And remember, this is only intermission.
We may not yet have reached our glory,
but I will gladly join the fight.
And when our children tell their story,
they'll tell the story of tonight.
They'll tell the story of tonight. Tonight.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear?
It's the perfect problem that we had was you can't put that group together physically, but we were able to do it virtually.
We've been told that the world will never be the same. There will be permanent changes that will take place as a result of this pandemic. What's the biggest permanent change that's going to take place at the zoo as a result of this, Randy Wistoff?
I think after this experience, we'll probably have more hand wash stations, hand sanitizers. I think that's probably going to stick. I'm not sure. We're too early to predict what else will change, but that for sure.
How about for you, Bob Kendrick?
Well, you know, I think about me from a more personal standpoint, because I'm so hands-on. And so you get down with the patron and they want to take pictures and they want to hug and shake hands and all of that stuff, which is so innate for me that I'm going to have to try and readjust how I interact with people. And that to me is as alarming as anything, because it's a part of who I am and I enjoy it immensely. And so that just interaction with our guests is going to change a little bit, at least. And I think it could change for quite some time, unfortunately.
Yeah. Brenda Tinnen.
Well, same as Randy and Bob, we had geared up, obviously, for the Big 12 with additional hand wash and sanitizing stations throughout the entire facility. I do not see those ever going away. I think one of the things that will change is that interaction between the artist and the fan. I'm not sure that you will ever see Bruce Springsteen do any crowd surfing in the future. I don't know if that crowd will be on the floor in those pits to catch him if he jumps off. I believe that most of the artists will discontinue the meet and greet and the photograph session that some fans pay additional for prior to the show, which is really sad, because I know that the artists look forward to it just as much as the fans. They like to have that. So that personal interaction, I believe, will change.
What is your view on when we might see the first show at Sprint Center?
Well, I'm waiting. I want to see what the NCAA does and what the universities do with fall basketball. As you know, we host the CBE Classic every year on the Monday and Tuesday prior to Thanksgiving. We've already announced the MUKU game, and it will be KU's home game at Sprint Center.
I'll go back to Brenda in a moment. She seems to be frozen for a moment in time. Might be because the new musical Frozen coming to Sprint Center shortly. But Richard, the biggest permanent change for you think will continue on at Starlight Theater as a result of this?
Probably the interaction again. Like everybody else has said, we'll certainly have the sanitation stations and new cleaning procedures that I think will outlive the pandemic. But just the fact, you have to rethink everything from the buffet foods that you used to serve, to the concession stands, to how the restroom lines are formed. And the thing I'll personally miss the most is at every Broadway show, I stand out and greet people as they come in. And, I'm used to shaking hands and occasionally getting hugs and that sort of thing. And I think people are going to be reluctant to do that. So it's like Brenda said, it's a little sad, but I think that's the planet we live in right now. So.
But what about even the future of Starlight? I saw at the very beginning of this program, we have a quote from you talking about losing more than $3 million just this season alone.
Yeah, in fact, it's probably going to be a little more than that. Our projection was if we had our limited series that now has a lot of those have gone away, it's probably going to be $4.5 million or so. And we're fortunate enough as a larger not-for-profit, we do have cash reserves that cover that, but basically that'll use up most of them. And so, you know, hopefully by this time next year, the pandemic is either gone or we have a vaccine, because if we go through another year of this, it's a real problem.
But I was just thinking about the zoo, Randy. I already asked Bob about what he thinks about the survival of the Negro League Baseball Museum, but you were supposed to be opening up a mammoth renovation project. You're going to be renovating the whole elephant exhibit. Did that actually happen? That was supposed to be open.
That's open, and we're in our test weekend, so we'll see how that goes. It's beautiful.
Okay. I'm going to go back to Brenda for a moment, and just before you're frozen. So I asked you, when will be the first show? Do you have a sense at this point in time when the first show will be at Sprint Center?
I have no artist that has said quantifiably that I will be there on this date for a show. But if there is an artist out there that is ready to go this fall, I'm ready to get them in there and get this city open.
Yeah, I will be in touch with you about that as I do my Elton John numbers for you, Brenda, personally.
Okay.
I'm looking forward to it. The world of Kansas City's big cultural attractions, as told this half hour by Randy Wistoff of the Kansas City Zoo, Brenda Tinnen, head of Sprint Center, Bob Kendrick of the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, and the man in charge at Starlight Theatre, Richard Baker. Thank you for pulling back the curtain on your worlds. I'm Nick Haynes. From all of us here at KCPT, have a safe and meaningful Memorial Day weekend. Keep calm and carry on.